Good morning. Welcome to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host. Delighted to have you with us on this beautiful morning. Before we get started, this is June 6th, and we'd like to acknowledge 78 years ago today, 160,000 U.S. and Allied soldiers landed on the beaches of Normandy. 4,400 Americans were killed that day. And oddly enough, churches and synagogues opened. Well, that day was a Tuesday, 78 years ago, for prayer, and they filled up. So we just like to remember all those who made that sacrifice. We're honored to have back in studio, he was with us in early February of this year, Dave Pollard, Registered Principal Branch Manager with Raymond James. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Little quick bio, 30 years as an investment advisor representative. Dave's accumulated the knowledge and experience to help clients navigate these troubled financial markets. He began his career in 1987 with Merrill Lynch in Alabama, in the great state of Alabama, in Anniston. He's been with Raymond James here in Carrollton since 1996. And in those past 30 years, you've seen it all.
I've seen a lot.
Good markets, bad markets, et cetera. And so the current economic situation now has reached everyone. There's not a human being on in America that is not being touched. And we're very fortunate, I think, in West Georgia to have our community and to be somewhat financially strong. But hopefully today we can get a little insight about what we face on the regular economic front from the stock market itself. So I'll let you kind of start it off. Interpret for us, those of us who may or may not be with a portfolio, may or may not have a 401k, what can we learn or see going on with the stock market in these times?
Well, I think probably the number one issue right now is fear. And back to your point of maybe we have, maybe we don't have a portfolio, just about everybody who is in the workforce has some sort of exposure to the market, and most of it is through their 401k. I will get younger folks that will come up that have got a 401k, they don't have anything outside of there, and they will, hey, do I need to stop, you know, do I need to put money over in cash? Do I need to stop making payments? And I'm like, no, you need to understand something. What's going on right now is absolutely what you want to take place, because if they're putting in on a systematic basis and prices are going up, they're paying much higher prices for per share of their mutual fund. They want prices to come down because they can accumulate more, and then as they get closer to the retirement, that's when they want prices going up. On the other hand, you've got a dilemma with the folks who have retired, that have rolled money over into their IRA and they're taking an income from it. They want prices to go up. And right now we're seeing prices come down. So it depends on who we're looking at. Some of the things that are going on right now, I guess at the heart of everything is it's troubling. We've got, I would say that 95% of the phone calls and the visits that I get to my office, the emotion that we're dealing with right now is fear. Sometimes that emotion that we're dealing with is greed. And greed is when the market is going up and everybody wants in. Fear is when there's so much uncertainty. I've made this comment, I think, every time that I sit in here, is that the market can climb the wall of worry, but it cannot stand uncertainty. It just needs to know what's going on. And right now, there's so much uncertainty that folks don't know exactly what to do. I will tell you, though, for the majority of the assets that we manage, it's with retirement income, or it's savings that people have built up literally over a lifetime, or it was an inheritance or something like that. So what their big question is what is going to happen? And right now, you know, we just, our crystal ball is muddy at best. As I've sat here with you over the past year, literally, we have been looking at the inflation numbers. And, you know, when we started talking about inflation here back in the fall, I think, the term that we use was transitional or transitory. When I was here with you in the winter, I think it was maybe January, February, we were saying, well, maybe the inflation numbers are not transitory. Maybe they are here to stay. Well, now we're looking at them, and you know, the gas. My wife filled up her car yesterday, and she has a vehicle that uses premium, and she said it was $4.80 over in Alabama. And so this inflation is not transitional, and it's what not wait and see. It's here, and it's pretty bad. You know, you don't have to tell a whole lot of folks that.
You used the words fear, emotion, greed. How do we separate our emotions from these times and whatever stocks we may or may not have, or how we navigate these waters?
You know, that's a good question. I don't know that you can. I know that one of the reasons that or one of the things, like I'm subjective to my own emotions on my own assets, and everybody is that way. So it really helps to have somebody that can look at it and say, hey, let's take a look at what the actual numbers are telling us, and let's invest money appropriately, not based on what you think is going on, because there really is a lot of reporting that we're getting right now that appears to be one thing, but in reality it might be something different. And so if we can look at numbers that are real, that are actual, we can make a little bit better decisions. I'll give you an example of that for just a minute. If you went and looked at year-to-date return numbers on the S&P 500, what you would see is we are down about 15-16% year to date. If you looked at that same number maybe a month ago, we were down up closer to 20% on the S&P 500. So we have seen, looking at the patterns of a lot of the individual companies that make up the S&P 500, we are starting to see where they have actually made a bottom, traded at their lowest point, and they're now trading in a pattern that makes it look like it might be a pretty good time to be buying them right here. Yeah. So if you can look at objectively at the information and make decisions that way, it's hard to get around those feelings when you're doing that.
And in emotions. Your terminology, that would be a bear market rally?
That would be a bear market rally. And what we hope is this is not a bear market trap, that we get caught putting money back in and where we're going to go back and retest those old lows. And one of the ways to offset that is, as opposed to just jumping back in full board with everything, is just move in tranches. Move a little bit in and see what happens. Move a little bit more in and see what happens. If you're fully invested and got caught in the sell-off, the best thing to do is just, if you own good quality companies that produce something that we have to have, then and they're making money doing it and they pay a good dividend, if you just sit tight, you're going to be fine. It'll work out.
Our guest this morning is Dave Pollard, registered principal at Raymond James, and we're talking about the economy, investments, the stock market, et cetera, et cetera. We'll be back with more after this.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at Tanner.org.
I'm Michael Flynn, Oak Mountain Academy class of 1978.
Katie Flynn, class of 2010.
Justin Flynn, class of 2014.
Logan Flynn, class of 2019.
And I'm Marnie Flynn, current teacher at OMA.
My uncle Richard Orm Flynn, a founding father of Oak Mountain Academy, had a vision to see students become confident leaders who hold a faith-based value system in an academically rigorous environment. We are proud to celebrate 60 years of fulfilling my uncle's vision.
Our family invites you to visit the campus or oakmountain.us today.
Good morning. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host, and I think for the first time in my life, I'm losing my voice, and that will please thousands of people. Some very close to me, actually. Last week, Janet Yellen, the former head of the Federal Reserve, which is not a government agency, correct?
That's correct.
Admitted she was wrong about inflation. The unanticipated and large shocks to the economy that boosted energy and food prices and supply bottlenecks that affected our economy badly. At the same time, she did not fully understand. What the heck? I mean, she's head of the Treasury, former head of the Fed, and she can't nail something as obvious as inflation.
You know, we all make mistakes, and
well, that's a pretty big one.
Yeah, well, it is a pretty big one. The good news is that she came out and admitted, "Hey, we just messed up." And you know, a lot of times when you just mess up, people are forgiving. It was the comment that followed that, maybe a day or two later, that made me raise my eyebrows, and that was that she said we may need another reconciliation package. Now, what that means in Fed speak is we need to put more money in the system. The problem with that is the money supply. The more money there is in the system, and the less products there are to buy, that's where the inflation is coming from. So she was really sorry that that she missed the numbers, but the answer was to increase the money supply, just to put more money out there. So to me, it did not make a whole lot of sense that we would increase money in the system when inflation is just absolutely on fire. And so, you know, one of the questions that we get is this an environment of hyperinflation? I'm not sure that you can measure. There's not a number out there that says this is hyperinflation. Hyperinflation, by definition, is when prices are increasing dramatically, swiftly. And I guess you could look at certain areas. Go ahead.
Well, and I think that's when we had Carter, or if you look at the Weimar Republic, or Venezuela,
right.
When it goes from inflation to hyperinflation, it goes quickly.
It does go quickly.
And people are almost blindsided. We talk about inflation, blah, 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 blah. But give it a few months, and we may see hyperinflation.
We very well could. Are we on the verge of Venezuela? At this point, I don't think so. But when we're putting more money into the system, or we're talking about putting more money into the system, and we've cut off the supply of oil, we've cut off the refineries, but we have not cut off the amount of people that are increasing their use of energy, hoping that we're going to go electric when there's not even an alternative that is there that is viable at this point, then all of a sudden it could go very quickly. You know, the big issue right now is, and we don't want to get off in the weeds too far, but the big issue right now is food supply. I personally don't think that it ever hits our nation the way that it hits the poorer nations, but we have seen recently the baby food issue. We're seeing food processing plants that are mysteriously catching on fire. And, you know, I guess it was maybe sometime last week that there was a chicken processing plant, I think in Minnesota, where 200,000 chickens were destroyed. At some point, if we continue to see limited supply, but this increasing money issue flowing through the system, we could get inflation that does become hyper. Again, what's that number? What's the mark? You know, nobody puts a real number on it. We just know that, man, it's going up increasingly fast.
So you attribute not only the war on fossil fuels, which is obvious, but the almost $2 trillion Biden spending plan,
sure,
that passed, and then all the money that we put into COVID and the money that we, you know, pay people not to work, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, the list seems endless.
It does. It's almost like everywhere you turn. I was telling some folks last week that if you ever played checkers and your opponent, it doesn't matter what move you make, they've got you. I mean, you can move here, but they're going to jump you. You can move here, but it's a double jump. I feel like we're almost in a checkers game where we've lost that wherever you turn, there's some issue there that, hey, man, this is not going to work either. So the big question becomes is, what do you do?
So we had a good jobs report. However, wages rose 5.2% for all employees over the past year. But But we still lost 3 percentage points in that we had 8% plus inflation.
That's right. And here's the other part of that good jobs number on Friday. The economy, when you look at the economy, the economy does seem to be doing okay. It's all of the stuff surrounding it. So, for example, we got a good jobs number on Friday. We got a good hourly pay number on Friday. And what the market says is, oh, wait a minute, good news is bad news. That means that the Fed is going to raise rates. That means that if they're going to raise rates, we have to do this. So, you know, we're hoping that we're in a sort of a dilemma or in which way do we go. Hopefully the Fed is going to use interest rates to give us a soft landing. Let's hope that they don't overreact and put us into recession.
So for an individual, and I know we face this during the Carter years, as inflation took off, the question becomes for the individual, they don't have a large portfolio, they don't have 401k necessarily, but they've got a little extra savings, and they see their savings being eroded by inflation. They go, oh my God, I'm looking at, you know, it may not be much, but this is my little retirement. What do you recommend? I mean, do we start chasing CDs and interest rates? Do we, you know, go try to find the next Apple and invest in individual stocks? What do you do?
Well, that is a really long-winded answer.
Question
to your question. That's right. No, the answer's long-winded. The question's a good one. So when you think about it, cash is the absolute worst place that you can be investment-wise. But what we see is a lot of people go, well, I know prices have gone up, I'll just dip into my cash a little bit. Well, eventually that cash is going to be eroded. But if your cash just sits there, and if you're getting, let's say you're getting 0.5% interest rate from the bank on it, but inflation is running at, by some estimates, north of 15%. If you go back and measure it according to the 1980, you mentioned Carter earlier, we're seeing inflation is actually running above 15%, but you're earning less than 0.5%. That's probably the asset that you're holding that's losing the most money. Do you go to CDs? Well, one of the benefits or one of the opportunities that we've seen with rates going up, we are seeing some interest rates on corporate bonds, on some CDs. They were getting 2.5%. So that's better than the 0.5% that you're giving. And you can go a year, 2-3 years on your maturity, and those things are still safe. Well, obviously, the best place to be is in owning something that produces stuff and that can be priced in as inflation increases. If you can't own a business, you can own a company. Like, for example, you think about a Procter & Gamble. You think about a Johnson & Johnson. You think about some of the food companies out there. They produce stuff we got to have. Southern Company, we got to have electricity. And they can sort of increase prices gradually to keep ahead of inflation. So not immediately, it's not going to just move up, but over time, it will grow in relation to inflation.
So those are defensive stocks, I believe they're called.
You can consider them defensive stocks.
So basically, those are the things we got to have.
You got to have it.
And we have a post here, I believe, saying that all those nasty... Mr. Armstrong contends that corporations, especially oil companies, are making record profits. They're price gouging and using inflation as a convenient excuse to do so. Comment?
I don't have a comment.
Our guest this morning is Dave Pollard, registered principal at Raymond James. We're going to be back with more after this.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at tanner.org.
As a believer in the power of education, we are called to set the standard by shaping and empowering the minds of future generations through quality education. Oak Mountain Academy embraces this philosophy, which is why my children attend this prestigious school. I am elated to serve on the OMA Board of Trustees, where together we prepare students and remind them to trust and believe in the power to transform the world. I'm Dr. Brian Bain, inviting you to celebrate our 60-year legacy of academic excellence. Visit us at oakmountain.us.
Good morning. Welcome back to Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host, losing my voice and to the applause of many. We are honored to have in studio Dave Pollard, registered principal at Raymond James, and we're talking about the economy, talking about the stock market, we're talking about investments, and we're going to keep going as long as we can. I've got so many questions that I want to hit, but I think before I go into the next one, it seems like we're very blessed in the sense that here in West Georgia, we've almost kind of a little bit insulated. I mean, we're on the fringe of Atlanta, yes, but Georgia's been fairly strong. And it looks like we might be able to weather the storms. Look like our local industries are doing good, are doing well, and hope to add jobs. I mean, do you get that sense that there's almost apples and oranges in a way?
You know, I do. I think that's an excellent point. We are, I like the term that you used, insulated. We do seem to be a little bit sheltered. We do seem to be a little protected out in the area that we live in. And you sort of looking at the areas like ours around the state and really like around the Southeast, it's almost like people really want to come here because things are going so well. The industry in our area does seem to be very strong. The employment situation in our area does seem to be very strong. And so you could almost say, well, you know, some of the stuff we're seeing going on nationally and internationally, it really doesn't affect us. And that's true. Except for when we go to the gas station or when we go to the grocery store, or when we think about paying taxes, or when we think about the sort of the fear that has encompassed the whole nation. So we've got, on one hand, we see these issues, we are affected by them a little bit, but we are in a place that we are sort of insulated from it.
We mentioned Janet Yellen, former Fed chair, now head of the Treasury Department. And I will restrain myself from saying anything else regarding her, which is not easy. Speaking of us versus the nation at large, the United States economy shrank 1.5% annualized rate in the first quarter of 2022 this year. So we've had two consecutive quarters of negative growth. So basically, the first quarter, we had a negative GDP. Correct?
Mm-hmm, that's correct.
That's not good. I know enough to know
That's not good.
I know that much. So that brings the R word around recession. Is that we talk about hyperinflation. Well, what about recession?
Well, one of the things you hope, and I mentioned this in the last segment, is that they do not control the economy so much with interest rates that they do put us into a recession. One of the things that we are seeing is that corporate earnings are actually outperforming what was estimated that they were going to be. Now, here's what happens, though. They lower those quarterly estimates, and then these corporations come in and they outperform those, and it looks good. But earnings numbers actually look okay. And the other really bigger indication, and again, not to get too technical, but when you look at the interest rates that high yield are, we refer to that as junk bonds, you know, the credit's not bad, not good, compared to the best credit worthy issues like the government or AAA corporate companies, what are those interest rates that both of those paying? Are they getting closer together in terms of the rate, or are they getting further and further apart? We are starting to see some separation. In other words, the high risk, those interest rates are starting to go up. The low risk, they're starting to separate. That's one of the best indicators of a recession that there is. And there's just not a huge gap right now. And again, I think that goes back to maybe the uncertainty that people are feeling. Is things really bad, or are they just okay? There's just a lot of uncertainty out there. So I don't know if we're heading to a recession or not. I guess that would be the point.
And I'm trying to occasionally bring us back to the individual investor.
Right.
If you now are thinking about investing in the stock market, how do you go about determining what a good buy is?
Okay, so let me, we've got just a couple of minutes left. I want to give you maybe just a couple of ideas. I do think that if you're going to keep ahead of inflation, you got to get out of cash, and people don't want to do that. You're not going to keep ahead of inflation with a 2% CD. That's just a fact. However, you do need some money there just for the safety aspect. If I need to go get some, I can go get it right there. The way you're going to keep ahead of inflation is by owning stuff. And that's why I go back to it is a good time to own stuff that produces things that we have to use. They're making money doing it. They have some control over price increases, but they're paying a dividend too. Their cash flow is the dividends are coming out of cash flow, and you can collect the dividend and get some price appreciation. So the problem with that is, though, is that people generally are very fearful. And again, I think this is one of my favorite ideas here lately, is there's actually two of them, but one is just to buy an ETF, an exchange-traded fund, that represents the S&P 500, and then use a really safe strategy that basically you insure that purchase, and that you do that by the purchase of a put option. Again, don't want to get too technical, but if you think about it like this, you own your house, and when you buy your house, you buy fire insurance on it, and if the house burns down, the insurance company will replace the value of the house for you. If the house doesn't burn, then the insurance was just an expense. You don't ever use it. That's very similar to the way this type of strategy works. You buy the S&P through the ETF. If it goes down, you exercise it and get your money back except for the cost of the insurance. If the S&P goes up, it just expires worthless and it was just an expense for you. So it's a way to be in the market and protect yourself to the downside. And it's a way to participate that if it goes up, you do have the expense of the insurance form, but it allows you to participate. A second way of doing that, or a place to put money, is because interest rates have moved up, there are things out there that pay interest that have moved down. One of my favorite things is preferred stocks. And again, I know this is going to get real technical, but preferred stocks are stocks that are preferred over common stocks, but they're usually a short-term financing arm for a company. For example, a Southern company, parent company of Georgia Power, they will issue a preferred stock that pays a dividend that's usually somewhere above 5%. It's going to mature at some point or has a call date that they're going to give you $25 a share for it. Those are trading now in the neighborhood of about $19 a share, 19 and some change, almost 20. But you can buy it at that price. At some point in the future, they're going to give you $25 a share. That would be what, 25% return plus a 5% dividend for you to hold on that you can collect as you hold on along the way. So those are just a couple of ideas quickly.
If someone wants to learn more, to get in touch with you, to discuss their portfolio, how should they go about it?
They can call our office here in Carrollton at 770-834-4455, or you can visit our website at raymondjames.com/partnersfinancial group. I almost forgot my own website address.
Well, I won't hold you to that. Thank you for coming in. I'd like to have you come in somewhat frequently in that the economy is going to become more and more of a big story.
So when everything is going up and everything's easy, will you let me come back in then?
We'll talk about it. Dave Pollard, our guest, and we hope you'll go out and make it a great day. You're in tune to WLBB.
National headlines and the